I was a little sister. I was too little to play baseball. I couldn't even operate the bat. But he was 6 years older than me. When he was very small, my dad said he disappeared. My mom couldn't find him. He was out playing. He had his cowboy hats and his chaps and his vest and his six-shooter and all this on. And he disappeared, and they couldn't find him. And they went door to door in the neighborhood looking for him. And they found him at a neighbor's house on the dining room table, right in the middle of the dining room table, standing up, telling him about all the rootin' tootin' places that he'd been and you know, all of his cowboy adventures. I was easy to tease because I took it so seriously. I mean, my very first crush, first boy that kissed me, it was like I came home from school one day and he and that boy were on my front lawn playing keep away with my diary.
That was one thing with Fred. He, I don't know how the other kids took it or knew so much, but I guess being a good student, good citizen, he always had a good relationship with his teachers. First of all, he started out from a young age not writing newspapers or articles, but he would take songs, any given song, and he would rewrite all the lyrics. Maybe, you know, you might think of Weird Al in what he does today before Weird Al was around.
He did parodies.
But yes, he did parodies, and he would take some great writing.
Did it up right to the end, actually.
Yeah, he did up to the end.
Until he lost.
So that was his first writing that I remember with him.
My face-to-face first time speaking with Fred was probably on the beach, either at T Street or at San Onofre when my daughter was surfing. Always prided himself on being the chronicler of the surf world in San Clemente. He was always very good about asking the parents who was out in the water so he could get the names and the spellings, and he got to know everybody. I think if you talk to any surfer in San Clemente, they probably had that moment. We had just moved here from the East Coast, and my daughter is a water bug, so she took instantly to surfing. Fred was always there, so he would always ask the parents, like, who's that, who's that, who's that? And my first communications with the great Fred.
And then in high school at San Clemente, he got on the staff for the Daily Triton. He started writing columns there, and then he started writing, while he was doing that, he would write sports articles for San Clemente High, and they would, you know, to be in the Sun Post. Fred had a photographic memory, and he knew the stats, all the batting averages, the pitching, the PCTs, he knew everything about baseball players, not just the Dodgers, but everybody, all the teams.
Last night in my dreams, walking hand in hand on a white sandy beach of San Clemente. We were playing in the sun, having so much fun on a white sandy beach of San Clemente. Sound of the ocean soothes my restless soul.
Our mom died in 1960, so I was 9, he was 12.
Yeah,
1960.
And it was there's a music store right next door to my dad's TV shop.
Our dad worked in Laguna.
Yeah,
there was
at Star Quarters.
There was a music store there.
And he suggested, after our mom died, give Fred a guitar and see. So he gave him a 4-string baritone uke.
Yeah,
and that's what he started out, and I remember he was so stoked when he first came out. Dad, I can play the theme song to Bonanza.
The name of the group was The Group that he first started. They played the high school, and they, at the Four Muses, they played at one of the music festivals that was as the Half Rights. Fred was lead guitarist, but he also was good at harmonies. I was appreciative to that because Fred kind of got me doing harmonies and that. Actually, music-wise, after he graduated USC in 1970. He got another band going, a bit different. It was a trio, Mark Morgan Trio. Mark Morgan was the kid down the street who we were out playing baseball, And we always felt bad for him because his mom had him in practicing his piano. His, he was doing organ back then.
On a white sandy beach, the San Clemente, the sound of the ocean soothes my restless soul.
When I first started the paper, I had asked Fred if he'd have any interest in joining me with launching it. Back then, when you read the Sun Post, it was a product of the Orange County Register. So, you know, a large percentage of the content was not about San Clemente. Fred was the voice of San Clemente. All of us read that paper and knew Fred's name, and, you know, he was, you know, Fred Swegles. When I was starting the paper, my initial thought was, I need Fred. So that was, I think, my first phone call, and Fred very graciously said, hey, with all due respect, I've been with the Register or this newspaper for over 40 some odd years. I can't leave it at this point. And so he graciously declined my offer. So I started the San Clemente Times in 2005. And Fred was a big fan, actually, believe it or not. Like early on, we would see each other and he would always compliment me on the paper. And I would say, thank you very much. It's a flattering, you know, to hear from Fred.
With me, he was a great uncle with my kids, and he took time with our family to do so many things. He took us to Mexico. We went on, in fact, with my grandson. He knew my grandson was interested in ancestry, so when my grandson was 18, we all went back to Massachusetts and did an ancestry thing with a Fuller family that came off on the Mayflower. And took us to all these different spots of interest where family members lived, those early family members. He was always there, you know, to take wedding pictures and all, you know, from the time they were babies on up.
And he never had his own kids, but he was great with all of our kids. He was like a big kid himself, as an adult, almost to the point where we go, Fred, you know, you should be doing that with him, but in an innocent way.
Yeah.
You know, he would be the one that he would put the kid in the shopping cart and, you know, push him around. All of our kids, at one time or another, our grandkids, he would have at the beach, and he would play in the sand and play with the buckets and the water and all that. But there, his favorite thing, I think, was the
stick,
what
game.
We called the stick game, where you get a pile of sand, you put a stick in it, and it's kind of like the old pickup sticks where you just take a little bit of sand away and take turns until the stick falls over.
Yeah.
And, you know, that person lost. When he would come over, he might have gone on a trip someplace, because he loved that. We didn't even touch on that, how much he loved to travel. But he would come back from these trips, and he'd come up to the house for dinner, whether it was for holiday or just get together for dinner. And he would always bring, you know, his computer and show us the photos from the trips. And he had his guitar. You know, or he'd be playing something, or he'd bring a little amp or something up, and, oh, you've got to hear this music. He was always sharing music that he found.
When he went to college, he went to USC on a full tuition-paid scholarship. He would come home, he would write articles a little bit in the summertime for the Sun Post, but then when he graduated, he had an offer from Newsweek, and he had an offer from the Register, but he wanted to do hometown. He loved San Clemente so much, and he wanted to be able to do human interest stories and that sort of thing. And he just loved San Clemente, so he had the offer at Sun Post, and although it paid less, he always said that was more important to him to be doing what he loved rather than the 9-to-5. The police department didn't have a photographer for crime scenes, so they asked him to come do it, and that was kind of his beginning of photography there, and it was quite traumatic for him. It went on to surf photography and that sort of thing. He, you know, but he did a lot of human interest, just kids at the beach or kids on summer vacation or whatever, playing in a mud puddle, and he would do a whole picture story on it. Contests on whose ice cream cone in the summer was going to melt the fastest, you know. He would make it fun for kids or whatever, but he loved just doing picture stories, which he continued to do throughout all the years that he was there.
And I constantly kept my thumb on Fred. Like, hey, you know, if you ever wanted to come over, Fred, love to have you. And he, you know, he very politely declined every single time until that fateful day, and I think it was 2018 when the Register shut the Sun Post down. Upon learning of that at about 10 or 11 in the morning, I instantly called his cell phone and said, "Fred, you ready?" And he goes, "Absolutely. As long as I don't have to cover city council, I'm in." I'm like, "You're good. You can cover whatever you want." After, you know, 13 years of trying, I finally added Fred to the roster.
They did have this cartoon called Sunny Post. And we don't know for sure who drew Sunny Post. It could have been Fred.
It had the earmarks of his type of cartoon work, though.
But nobody ever really knew who Sunny Post was. And what Sunny Post did is every week, it would be a little cartoon in the paper with either a fun, a whimsical, a little satire, or maybe politics or something, but just really fun and a little laugh. I do have a t-shirt that I found of Fred's that I kept, and I'm going to proudly wear. If you see me on the beach trail, that's me wearing it. On the back, a big picture of Sunny Post, and it says, "I am not Sunny Post." So he's...
But we knew he was.
But we knew he was.
He later admitted that he was Sunny Post.
Yeah.
I don't recall the exact first stories, but I can tell you, you know, when we talked about his column, he said, "Look, I want to do something that celebrates this community and the people." And he goes, "I want to go deep into the things that make San Clemente unique." I said, "You can go wherever you want with this column." And he called it Coastlines. A couple of the early stories that I absolutely loved, one of them was on the city street names and kind of what they meant. What does, you know, Avenida Del Mar mean? Obviously, you know, you don't need to know a lot of Spanish to figure that one out. But, you know, what do the other ones mean? Why is there a Camino de Estrella? Who was that named after? Things like that. So, you know, he had that ability to kind of pull out, you know, the very essence of the community through stories that, you know, on the face of it don't sound that sexy. But when you start writing it out, you're like, wow, that's really interesting. I'd never thought about that. Another one he did on the wind vanes that you see around town. There's ones with surfers, there's ones with, you know, the moon, there's ones, you know, and he was, you know, very, very conscious of his surroundings. And I think, you know, he loved everything San Clemente. I mean, we'd been around 15 years already, so I think we had the credibility of being a quality newspaper. However, when you add a legend to your roster, it can do nothing but make your product better and more important. He absolutely did that.
Well, even towards the end, he still had so many ideas in his head. When he would come in to present an idea to write an article about for the paper, he'd say what it was, and then he'd say, "And then I want to write this, and then this, and then this," and they'd say, "Hold on, Fred," because he'd have them stacked up in his brain just like a file of stuff that was waiting to move forward.
Our office is in Capo Beach. He would ride his bike all the way down and up over to our office, pull in, join the editorial meeting. I couldn't wait till we get to Fred. And I don't think all of us were excited about when we got to Fred, because Fred didn't just say, "Well, I'm going to work on this." Fred would go into this passionate oration about all the things he's thinking about. Just basic stories about the community and interesting people in it, and the passion Fred brought to that conversation. I can tell you, I benefited from it. Every single one of our journalists that have been there and worked alongside Fred and got to sit down in those meetings benefited from that.
He had so many friends throughout the world that he did things for that we didn't find out until later. Some of the things that he did for people in other countries and had stayed in contact with. He was just a giver of himself, a very humble person who not only just would give and give and give of himself for San Clemente and his family and any friends that he knew here.
Every time we would be with Fred, people were always coming up to him. He knew everybody. And I remember talking with him on the pier, and someone would come up and they're talking, the person would leave, and I'd say, "Who was that?" And he'd say, "Oh, that was so-and-so." And I go, "Oh my God, I knew that person," but I didn't really realize, you know. He knew everybody. Actually, until his illness was announced, I don't even think I realized the impact. Because he'd done so much with helping as far as photographing families, kids, the photos and the articles. When he wrote an article, I remember him mentioning to me how I have to get this just right. The facts need to be correct. He traveled a lot. I mean, that was another big part.
He traveled and he didn't travel in hotels. He would take the bus or, you know, he'd fly to something and then take, you know, whatever local transport there was with just a backpack and his camera.
Yeah.
When he went to Easter Island, and he knew they didn't like to have their picture taken. The locals there didn't. They felt that it might take your spirit away. So he didn't take his fancy cameras. He took one of those instant Polaroid cameras where you got an instant picture. And he met with a group of people on the beach, and he pulled this thing out, and they kind of backed off, and he took a picture of his feet. And then he got the picture out of it and let them watch his feet come in. And he handed it to them. And they wanted their feet taken too, so he took pictures of their feet.
Yep.
And then pretty soon he took like a selfie. And this was in the 70s. He took a selfie and then watched the picture come in, handed it to him. He wound up getting pictures of all of them. He came home with four pictures out of, he had so many packets of the instant film, but everybody wanted their picture. And anyways, through that he got invited home, and he always would stay with the locals wherever it was that he went. That's kind of how he figured out what would appeal to them, and then he really get personal with them. I mean, he that's how he made so many friends.
When the Padres were still a minor league team, I remember they somehow he got them to donate some jerseys they weren't using anymore.
It was another, what it was a trip to Mexico that he'd taken, and he got off the bus and he found a bunch of kids. He met the kids first. They were playing football in the town square with a dilapidated football, soccer ball. And so he showed them a little bit about American football. And then he went back again. He, you know, got in with the locals, stayed with the local people. He went back again. It was baseball season.
Yeah.
And they didn't have uniforms. They didn't have anything, really. It was a poor little village. Mm-hmm. And so that's where he arranged to get the Padres, the San Diego Padres, their
uniforms.
And took them down, and the mothers remade them into the right sizes for the kids.
Decades ago, and the guys would go down surfing down there, but the locals would stand on the beach and they didn't surf, and they would just watch these Americans, or I don't know, maybe some other countries, other citizens as well, but they would watch the surfers out there. And Fred was instrumental in getting, helped to get surfboards down there and get the locals out in the water. And then eventually, was it Kelly Slater that, anyway, they ended up getting the first surf contest down there, so.
And now they have a whole little surf culture, and he up until the end was still in contact with the family down there that they all brought this together.
Fred couldn't say it in his own words, you know, how much he just loved everybody. He really loved the city, he loved the people. He went to the doctor because he was having some speech problems. And we all kind of thought at first, ooh, maybe he had a stroke.
He sent me a text and it was all garbled. The text was all a bunch of X's and Y's and just nonsensical stuff. But it might have a regular word in between the sentence.
Yeah.
And so I finally called him and I said, Fred, what's up? He said, I don't know. And he said, I'm just having a hard time speaking and writing. And I said, you need to go to the doctor. You know, you need to tell Barbara you need to go to the doctor.
Yeah.
He called me to tell me that he had gone to the hospital, been diagnosed with this illness.
First they were saying they thought it was a stroke. But then they looked further into it and they found that he had this brain tumor, glioblastoma. And what we found out immediately was there's no cure.
I kept saying to Fred, like, hey, Fred, worry about yourself. Focus on your health. We're here. We got you. You know, we're not going anywhere. Your column's yours. We keep paying you. Like, please don't think for a second. Because he was very caught up in not wanting to let the team down. Didn't want to miss a deadline. Wanted to make sure my managing editor, Sean, was aware of, you know, the fact that he was dealing with this, but he was not going to miss a deadline.
It starts in the brain. It doesn't spread to other parts of the body. They can do surgery. They can get most of it out, but without destroying the rest of your brain, they can't get the whole thing out. So they treat it, But we were told from day one that this thing, he'll be okay for a while, and then it'll come back with a vengeance, and then, you know, there's nothing they can do.
The next thing you know, Fred's on the screen on our Zoom calls, and he's got like this white mesh, you know, thing over his head. We're like, what's that, Fred? He's like, oh, I was at the hospital and I had to shave my head because I had to go take a look, and they're gonna, I'm like, wow. And, you know, and here he is on these Zoom calls from his bedroom in San Clemente, you know, and he never missed a call.
He'd have this aphasia where he couldn't communicate very well, couldn't write, couldn't speak. But then they'd give him steroids and it would get better. So there was a period here and there where he could write. And then it would go back again where he couldn't.
Fred was very aware of what this meant. He wouldn't let on. He wasn't sad about it. He didn't, you know, pout about it. But he did ask me on several occasions to come over to his apartment. He wanted to show me where the photos were, where his archives were. You know, Barb was really she was amazing. She was so strong and a great communicator, really stepped up, and she knew how important our connection was for his work.
He would have us looking at his computer for research, you know, articles that he was working on, because he wanted to finish these articles, and there's some he never did get to finish.
This terrible disease that he had that incapacitated his ability to put into writing what was in his head, and the fact that he couldn't communicate it was the cruelest of cruelest ironies, and just not fair at every level for this man, this prideful man. Fred did not want it communicated publicly, but once he got admitted into the kind of assisted living area, Barb asked him, are you okay with people kind of writing you cards and coming in? And he said, yeah, that's okay. So I wrote a column. I actually read it to him verbatim. I went in and sat with him and I said, is this okay? And he goes, yeah, that's okay. So I put that in the paper.
Being the humble guy that he was, he didn't want anybody to know. Yeah. Don't let anybody know. Don't tell anybody. I don't want any attention. And he was like that. I mean, he was the guy who didn't want the office at work to know it was his birthday because he didn't want the attention.
We probably got 30 to 40 cards a week. I tried to go every week. It was more likely every other week. And I would bring the stack of cards and I would read every single one to him. But it was degrading. Like you could see, like it was, you know, the ability to kind of connect to that was degrading over time.
He started saying, you know, I'm really lonely. We said, well, Fred, you didn't want people to know. And so he finally agreed it's time, it's okay to let people know. So that's when we let Norb at the paper know at the San Clemente Times, and he put something in. The support was just overwhelming.
Oh, yeah.
Just really overwhelming.
In his room, he had so many cards. I wound up, got permission, and wound up making pieces of twine tacked up so it could hang like Christmas cards.
Yeah.
And he had row after row after row of all the cards that came in on all walls and above doors.
Yep.
There were so many, there was almost hardly any wall space left that I could hang more cards.
And my wife, Alyssa, would join me many times. We'd go over and read the cards to him. They have a very beautiful little outdoor seating area where he was staying. It was beautiful, birds chirping. The sun was out, you know, we'd get to sit outdoors, he'd eat while I read the cards to him. I made sure he knew everybody was thinking about him, and he really appreciated it. His eyes would well up with tears.
You know, he had an amazing attitude during the whole thing. It's hard to know if that happens to you or something similar happens to you, what your attitude's gonna be, but he, throughout the whole thing, it was like, let's tackle it. Let's do what we can.
Do what we can while we can do it.
It was fun to see so many people whose lives Fred did touch. Being a private guy, he told the family, do not do it. I do not want a celebration of life. I don't want anybody to make a big deal about me. But is it okay if I organize something with a bunch of friends? And so Greg Cruz, who's a local businessman who ran the WSA and USA Surfing. He was the president of USA Surfing when USA Surfing went to the Olympics for the first time. I called Greg and I said, hey, would you help me if I pulled a paddle out together? Would you help me? He said, absolutely. So we worked with a lot of folks, including yourself. I never even heard of a paddle out when I lived on the East Coast. And when I moved to California and been in the surf industry for a while, you know, I unfortunately attended a handful of them. Glassy fall day in San Clemente, I mean, it couldn't have been a better tribute to Fred. Just to be part of that ring and be part of that circle and be out in the water, there's something deeper there. And you know, you take a minute to think about your friend. Great moment. We were close to the pier. His sisters and brother were up on the pier. They could, you know, participate. They could share in that.
Visit him the last few weeks in hospice, and some days he would just be sleeping the whole time, but we were told that your hearing is the last to go, so be mindful of what you're saying around him. It was baseball season, so whenever we could, we'd have the Dodgers game on, or we would have the iHeart app on his phone so he could listen to Dodger talk or whatever, because he was just really loving that. He couldn't really express himself very well. It was more like yes or no, that kind of a thing.
Pantomime.
Or hand gestures. Maybe about a week before he passed, we walked in his room, and he just perked up and he said, I am so happy.
Yeah, I mean, after he hadn't been able to speak for so long.
He other than that, he was just trying to get words out, but he had this one full sentence, and it was, he just perked up, his personality just was amazing. So that to me was the best memory of towards his end time that I'll carry with me always. I was about a half an hour late getting to see him before he passed. Valerie was...
Yeah, she was on her way from San Diego.
I was on my way from my kids in San Diego, and I was going to come visit him that day anyway, but I missed him by about a half an hour. Valerie was with him.
Yeah, I was with him. He was laboring in his breathing. You know, he couldn't really speak, but I just held his hand and quoted a scripture to him. For all things, I have strength by him who imparts power to me. And he looked at me and he nodded. He totally understood and held his hand, and then he just quit breathing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it was peaceful.
This community is so blessed to have had someone like Fred who cared so passionately about this place that he chronicled the happenings of this community for over 50 years. He was thrilled to do that, John. And for us to have benefited from that, I always had that appreciation because I started there. I think more and more everybody that lives in this community that, whose lives he touched also appreciate that. I think they know that. It's where dreams really do come. I think he would just say, enjoy every single day and appreciate what you've got.
He would love everybody just to love each other.
Yeah.
And support each other.
Yeah. That would be his message, I think, really.
I think he would just say, don't overcomplicate things. Don't lean into the material side of life so much. Just enjoy your friends, enjoy your community, enjoy life. I think that would be what he would ask us to do. I certainly plan on doing that. Yes, we do love you, Fred. We miss you already.
Spanish Village by the sea, and keep it that way by not drawing apart, but by drawing together.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's a good way to say it.
Black lemon drops high upon the chimney tops. That's where you find me. So. Yeah.